Thank you. Thank you very much. It is a pleasure to be speaking here tonight. I have spoken to a few affiliates of the World Affairs Councils in the past, and I've always enjoyed it and found the interaction with the members just really gratifying, and it is an honor to be speaking to you. There's a bit of a personal connection, too. The head of the National the Umbrella Group World Affairs Councils of America is Lori Murray, who is a friend and is married to the guy who brought me to Washington many years ago to work for the Wall Street Journal there. And Al Murray is still a very good friend. So you guys do great work, as does, of course, the University of Connecticut. And it's also gratifying to see so many people come in here and talk about a somewhat academic-sounding topic. And it just, I think, demonstrates, I'm trying not to sort of see it as a, flattering to me personally, but a hunger for information and context about what's going on in the world. You know, several times a week, the President of the United States attacks us as a dishonest media, and our circulation keeps going up every time he does that. Creates some odd sort of incentive problems, I guess. And but what I take it as is that it's just creating a great hunger out there and a need for understanding and context for these confusing times. I remember during the financial crisis, Greg Mankiw was asked what it was like being an economist. He said, like an undertaker during the Black Death. Times are difficult and business is good. And so that's kind of like what I feel. And tonight, what we're going to talk about is what you're going to see is a little bit of the consequence of my own efforts to understand what's going on around us. Because, like most of you, I'm used to thinking of the big political questions of our day being easily decided as liberal versus conservative, left versus right. But it's clear that that is not a very good framework for thinking about what's been going on now. For example, last year, those of us who were following Donald Trump during the presidential campaign, and after all, who wasn't, we're sort of scratching our heads trying to figure out what this guy's ideology was in the first place. I mean, here was a guy who wanted lower taxes and less regulation, just like a standard conservative Republican. But he also wanted, but he was also very, very opposed to free trade, and he didn't want to touch entitlements like Social Security, just like a liberal Democrat. And then, of course, he was extremely critical and negative towards immigration. And that's the kind of thing that we were more used to hearing in Western Europe than in the United States. So the reason we were struggling to pin down Trump's politics is that we were working from what I would say was this familiar axis of left versus right that I was telling you about a second ago. And yet Trump has made clear to us on quite a few occasions that he's operating along a different sort of axis. And I would call this axis nationalist versus globalist. Here's what he said a few days after the election when he went to Ohio to celebrate his election victory. This was also on his way to Indianapolis to celebrate the fact that he had persuaded Carrier Corporation not to outsource 800 jobs to Mexico. He said, "There is no global anthem, no global currency, no certificate of global citizenship. We pledge allegiance to one flag, and that flag is the American flag. From now on, it's going to be America first." And then in his inauguration speech, he once again hit hard on this theme. He said, "Every decision on trade, on taxes, on immigration, on foreign affairs will be made to benefit American workers and American families. We must protect our borders from the ravages of other countries making our products, stealing our companies, and destroying our jobs." Now, these themes were all kind of like new and surprising, a little bit unsettling to American ears. But if you were in France, you would have heard something very similar for a long time. In fact, here's what Marine Le Pen, leader of the National Front in France, said in late 2015, after she had lost an election for a regional government after the two main centrist parties joined forces to oppose her. She said, "The split today is not between left and right, but between globalists and patriots. The globalists acting for the dilution of France and its people in a giant global magma, versus the patriots who believe that the nation constitutes the protective space for the French, which means all of you." And these themes, once again, you could hear them in the campaign when Britain was deciding whether to vote to leave the European Union. And after they decided, voted yes, and Theresa May basically became Prime Minister to replace David Cameron and leader of the British Conservative Party, here's what she said. "Too many people in positions of power behave as though they have more in common with international elites than with the people down the road, the people they employ, the people they pass on the street. But if you believe you're a citizen of the world, you're a citizen of nowhere. You don't understand what the very word citizenship means." So a very striking similarity and resonance between these three very different leaders of three very different countries. All these leaders are positioning themselves as nationalists, taking on the ideology of globalism. Now, what is globalism? It's not the same as globalization, and that's an important distinction. The idea of globalization is the process by which capital and people and goods move ever more freely across borders. And you can talk about that in a somewhat dispassionate way. But globalism is the belief that globalization is natural, inevitable, and good, and that it inevitably diminishes the role of the nation state and expands the role of global institutions, whether it's the United Nations and the World Trade Organization, or the European Union, or NATO. Now, established politicians, indeed many of us, and I would include put myself in this group as well, would have been perplexed a little while ago to be described as an ideologue because we believe in globalization. And then to hear globalism described as an ideology. I mean, after all, how could globalism be an ideology when it's shared by ideological opposites like Bill and Hillary Clinton versus the Bushes, or by David Cameron and Tony Blair? But it is an ideology. Also, make no mistake. And the nationalists like Trump, Le Pen, and Theresa May, they define themselves in opposition to this ideology. They believe that national identity and borders remain vital attributes of their countries. And globalists, they believe, are hell-bent on destroying those things, and they must be stopped. And the electoral success of these nationalists suggests that there are many voters who agree with them. Now, the two axes I've just described, left versus right, globalist versus nationalist, they are not mutually exclusive. In fact, I prepared the following chart as a way to explain how we should think about these things. I think you can try and place all leaders today in one of four quadrants of this graph, from somewhere from left to right, and from nationalist to globalist. And what you will see is that there are individuals who share certain attributes with people across that left-right divide, but not on the nationalist-globalist divide, and vice versa. So for example, Donald Trump and Marine Le Pen share much of the same basic nationalist credo. They have this strong antipathy towards globalization and its institutions, such as NAFTA in the case of Donald Trump, or the European Union in the case of Marine Le Pen. And they're very hostile towards immigration. Both favor maintaining generous entitlements, especially for the native-born elderly. Both are skeptical of Western military alliances, and they're, you know, not so sure why we should always be treating Russia as a geopolitical adversary. But on the more traditional left-right divide, they're very far apart. Marine Le Pen is an old-style kind of like statist. She favors much more state control of the French economy, higher minimum wage, abortion rights, whereas Trump, of course, is opposed to government interference with business, has a very deregulatory agenda. He believes in less invasive labor laws and more restrictions on abortion. So not every policy choice or election comes down to a choice between nationalists and globalists. Often, as we have seen in many of the debates in Washington in recent weeks, it's that old divide between left and right that continues to matter more. Yet I believe that the greater ruptures to the status quo that we're going to witness in coming years will be along this new nationalist-globalist divide. Why now? Why now, 8 years after the global financial crisis, are we now seeing this schism appear? So what I'm going to argue is that globalism basically had a great run, several centuries in fact, but that it eventually overreached, and it succumbed to its own economic failures and its own cognitive blind spots. And those blind spots were further exploited by outside forces such as Islamic terrorism. Now, to really throw a lot of history in here, this is not my strong suit, so to some of you who are genuine historians, I'll probably sound a bit like a prima donna, but please go easy on me, but I'm learning like everybody else. But really, you have to go back to the 1600s to understand the birth of the idea of nationalism as we think of it now. In 1648, the Peace of Westphalia brought an end to the 30 Years' War, which was basically a titanic war between Catholic and Protestant forces in Central Europe. And it was the end of the then great global hegemon, a force of global governance, which was the Holy Roman Empire. And in its place, the nation-state became the basic unit of governance, and national self-interest became the guiding force of what rulers of the countries did. This system, modified by the Congress of Vienna after the Napoleonic Wars of 1815, gave rise to a rough sort of like self-stabilizing balance of power that for a couple of centuries largely avoided great power conflict. Yet even as the nation state was becoming the building block of international relations and identity, there were economic forces starting to chip away at it. Indeed, I can say that globalism is founded, is fundamentally an economic concept at its root. As a discipline, and anybody who studied economics knows this, we look at human beings and we reduce them to these curves. We take human beings with all their needs and wants, all their complex emotional aspects, and we basically reduce them to this bloodless quantitative concept that can be quantified in the form of income and utility and welfare. The founding insight of economics is that trade is beneficial. Two people are better off specializing in trading with each other rather than trying to do everything themselves. The same is true of two cities, and the same is true of two countries. The great insight in economics was 200 years ago this year when David Ricardo wrote in the Principles of Political Economy and Taxation, his book, The Principles of Political Economy and Taxation, and he came up with the concept of comparative advantage. He wrote, "Under a system of perfectly free commerce, each country naturally devotes its capital and labor to such employment as are most beneficial to each. This binds together by one common tie of interest and intercourse the universal society of nations throughout the civilized world." So there you had it. David Ricardo had just used the new tools of economics to explain why economic forces would invariably create this community of nations. That is as close as you will get to a founding principle of globalization as you'll ever hear. Britain presided over the first great era of globalization in the 1800s. It adopted the gold standard at the end of the Napoleonic Wars. And then a few decades later, it basically also adopted free trade with the repeal of the Corn Laws. Now, it's important to realize that for Britain, these were not sort of like great magnanimous gestures to the world. They were purely acts of narrow self-interest. By this point, of course, Britain was the world's preeminent manufacturing power, and it didn't really need to worry about imports, competition from imports. But it did see a great benefit to reducing the price of imported corn. And the gold standard, of course, facilitated London's role as a center of international finance, and which helped it recycle gigantic British profits earned on its foreign possessions into new investments for the rest of the world. But this great system, both the Westphalian balance of power and the gold standard and free trade, this huge architecture of globalization and international relations, came crashing down with World War I. And a new system did not take its place until after World War II. The broad shape of that system, which we still have today, is well known to you all. Essentially, it's the United States at the center of a network of alliances with its mostly democratic developed allies around the world, such as NATO, as the guarantor of the security of the Western democracies, Western liberal democracies. And economic relations were completely intertwined with all those geostrategic aims. Harry Truman, in 1947, speaking in favor of the ratification of the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, which was a forerunner to the World Trade Organization, he said, "If the nations can agree to observe a code of good conduct in international trade, they will cooperate more readily in other international affairs." There you see, right from the early days of the post-war era, the intertwining of economic and geostrategic policy. Now, if the building blocks, if the root of economics was one, if the root of globalism was one economic rule, which is comparative advantage, this new version of globalization drew on another rule of economics, which I call game theory. Now, you all are aware of the prisoner's dilemma, you know what I mean? Two people are captured, they're both best off if neither of them says anything, but if one of them confesses, then the other goes, but if one of them implicates the other, he goes to jail, but if they both implicate each other, they both go to jail. And taken to the global level, what does this mean? It means that countries cooperating instead of competing are actually better off. So when it comes to trade, if you lower your trade barriers and you persuade your trading partner to lower their trade barriers, you're both better off than if you both raise trade barriers and you end up in a protectionist trade war. The same is true in the geopolitical sphere. An organization like NATO is based on the notion of mutual defense. An attack on one is an attack on all. And therefore, by aligning yourself to a country that might be attacked by an adversary, you make it less likely that any of you will be attacked. And this system worked incredibly well. From the 1950s to the 1990s, standards of living throughout the Western world rose continuously and dramatically, and there was no great power war between these countries. And politics mostly aligned along that familiar left-right axis, issues of wages, taxes, rights of labor, rights of business. And geostrategy and economics and globalization became ever more tightly bound. I just go to 1994, when Bill Clinton was facing the decision of whether to ratify NAFTA. One of his great rationales for doing that was the belief that this could turn Mexico, which had long had an antagonistic relationship with its neighbor to the north, into a stable pro-American ally. George W. Bush, signed a free trade agreement with Australia, basically to reward it for participating in the second Iraq war. The European Union admitted the former Soviet satellites of Eastern Europe, largely to try and draw them permanently out of Russia's orbit. So in each of those steps, you can see how what ostensibly looked like an economic decision was in fact part of a larger geostrategic design. But globalism wasn't just about geostrategy, it wasn't just about politics. It started to take on the trappings of a cultural mindset. Borders came to be seen not just as impediments to economic efficiency, but to social and cultural advance. Now, this is partly self-serving. It was most prominently advanced by those who stood to benefit the most. I think of the companies and the individuals whose skills were so much in demand in the hyper-globalized worlds of technology and finance. Partly it just reflected the intermingling of elites at places like Davos and Aspen and top universities, all speaking the lingua franca of English and economics. Samuel Huntington, the political scientist, captured this divide between globalists and everybody else, and the countrymen, in an essay in 2004 where he coined the term Davos man to describe these people. He wrote, "These transnationalists have little need for national loyalty. They view national boundaries as obstacles that thankfully are vanishing, and they see national governments as residues from the past whose only useful function is to facilitate the elite's global operations." Now, more important, this is also the era when, in my view, globalists overreached. It had worked so well up to date, so why not continue with the lessons of the past? In 2000, Bill Clinton signed legislation that allowed China to join the World Trade Organization. And his logic was much the same as Harry Truman's was half a century earlier. It was geostrategic. Trade will make China more like us. China's membership in the WTO will open China to information and ideas from around the world and strengthen the rule of law in China. It is likely to have a profound impact on human rights and political liberty. Well, that would be one of Clinton's worst forecasts ever. It didn't happen. The idea that it would make China more liberal and friendlier was a mirage. The Communist Party became more repressive and authoritarian at home, and it has become more antagonistic abroad with its neighbors. And the same kind of, faulty logic happened in Europe, where the globalists also overreached. The euro, which came into being in 1999, it was a crowning achievement of the European project, which had been underway since the Treaty of Rome in 1957. They'd already knocked down barriers to goods and services and capital. They had, more of the trappings of a common government and the European Commission. Monetary union, where they basically abolished individual currencies, was the natural first step. And the architects of the European project believed that this would eventually erase the remaining distinctions between member countries. But that didn't happen either. That also was a pretty bad forecast. In fact, what happened was the fundamental differences the countries remained. Germany was a high-saving, competitive, low-inflation country. Italy, Spain, and Greece were all kind of the opposite. But they no longer had the safety valve of the euro that would reconcile those differences in an economic equilibrium. Instead, it fooled people into thinking it was just as safe to lend to Greece as it was to Germany. A gigantic debt boom ensued, and eventually these countries accumulated debts that they could not pay back, and we got a crisis, which we are still working our way through. It was, of course, in finance that globalists overreached the most. I still, almost laugh when I remember that in 2008 I was writing about this big report that Hank Paulson brought in. Now, Paulson was a former chief executive of Goldman Sachs. He was George Bush's Treasury Secretary. And he had devoted himself to the idea of financial reform. And the priority to him was basically ensuring that U.S. banks and financial companies could compete on a level playing field with global banks in these globalized capital markets. And of course, approximately 2 weeks after he wrote that, those globalized capital markets melted down. Awesome timing. Now, remarkably, this crisis, though it was so global in scope, did not undermine initially the consensus in the established centrist parties for globalism. Think of Barack Obama. He enters office, he's somewhat skeptic for free trade, but he very soon turns into this champion for the Trans-Pacific Partnership, a 12-nation agreement. It's not just about free trade. We're going to have common rules about software, about intellectual property, about drugs, about digital protectionism, about labor rights and environmental rights. This was going to be the way to create a, you know, an economic alliance of like-minded countries led by the United States against China. But beneath the surface, there's trouble brewing. One factor, of course, was on the economic front and the stark contrast between the fortunes of those who prosper under globalization and those who suffer. Now, this slide is based on data compiled by Branko Milanovic, and he basically maps across this chart how has everybody on the planet performed in this era of globalization from 1988 to 2008. And as you can see, everybody from the 5th to the 80th percentile in the global income spectrum has done massively better. And then you see people at the 100th, the really rich people, the ones who all graduated from UConn, doing incredibly well. It's those folks at the 80th and the 95th percentile, and those are the working classes of the United States and Western Europe, and they're the ones who didn't do so well. Globalization has been amazingly good for the middle class of the emerging markets, in particular China, not so much for the working class of Western Europe and North America. And as for China, we talked about how our dreams of turning it into a Jeffersonian democracy in our image were shattered. Well, it didn't really work out in terms of free trade either. And China did and has adhered very carefully to the rules of free trade, the letter of free trade, but has systematically violated its spirit with a very nakedly mercantilist trade and currency policy, has systematically advantaged its own companies and products, and has racked up huge trade surpluses. This chart, which goes back to the 1830s, just shows the astonishing expansion of China's role in global trade, and almost all of that occurring since it joined the WTO in the year 2000. But one study estimates that roughly 2 million Americans lost their jobs because of the shock of China's imports. And, you know, I think most Americans get it, that, like, jobs are lost, jobs are gained, that's the way it goes. And most Americans fundamentally believe in trade. But I think most Americans fundamentally believe that there's something wrong when, for every dollar we sell, the China sells us, we only sell 20 cents to China. That just didn't seem fair. And it's very hard to explain why these 2 million people had to lose their jobs when you couldn't point to the 2 million people who got jobs by doing business with China. And that is something David Ricardo didn't think about or incorporate into his models 200 years ago. That's one of the areas where economics has failed us, because it doesn't sort of capture the sense of fairness and the distribution of outcomes from economic transactions. Anyway, while China was in some sense undermining the case for free trade, our wars in Iraq and Afghanistan were undermining the traditional belief in the U.S.'s role as an international security guarantor. And coincidentally, the burden of both of these things fell predominantly on the white working class in this country. Another problem globalists have is that the insistence on seeing most of the world's problems in economic terms, which is actually kind of tone deaf. In fact, if you look at this slide, this is based on a study by two people at Harvard, where they basically went through the manifestos of political parties in roughly a dozen Western democracies to try and sort of classify what are the types of issues where they focus their attention. And what they found was that since the 1970s, economic issues such as wages and unions and so on have become less important, and non-economic issues such as national security and abortion and immigration have become more important. And yet globalists continue to frame most problems in economic terms. So for example, when they see opposition to immigration, globalists tend to attribute this to fear of competition with low-wage workers. And yet reams of research show that this is not the real story. It shows that opponents of immigration are primarily not motivated by what it means for them personally, but what it means for the community and their nation. It is the case that some of these people are, you know, ethnically intolerant or racially intolerant. But many just ordinary people who take comfort from things like shared familiar customs, values, and language. And they care about borders. Borders, after all, represent the prerogative of a country to decide who and what comes into that country. And illegal immigration to these people inverts the contract by basically allowing the immigrant to decide who gets to come rather than the country. The significance of these issues became especially clear in the Brexit campaign, where immigration was the deciding factor. One study found no correlation between a region's vote. In fact, I'll show some charts here. I hope you can see them there. It's a little bit faded, but this was very interesting, especially against the assumption that most of the unhappiness about Brexit was an economic issue, or even about immigration. So what? This is a chart by several British economists. And essentially what they've tried to do is they looked at several hundred British voting districts, and they examined each of those districts. What was the performance of things like wages and employment, and how did they vote on Brexit? And what they discover is that this chart where they plotted the Brexit vote against median wages, no correlation here. Now, since all of you are taking advanced statistics here at UConn, I know that I don't need to explain any of this to you. Slower people like me have to sit down and stare at it for several hours. We're still sort of like taking it on trust. But what this is basically telling you is that there's nothing to see here, folks. We cannot explain why people voted for Brexit using the history of how wages behaved in that area. This, however, with the miracle of least squares and regression analysis, we can see a very strong positive correlation between the growth of the migrant share of a district's population and the decision to vote for Brexit. What is this telling you is that Brexit was primarily driven by people who did not like what was happening to the communities where they lived. And what I think it tells you is that Britain could have had more control over immigration, which it basically gave up by joining the European Union. It would have stayed in the European Union. Brexit would have lost, but that choice wasn't there. Look, I'm an economics guy, okay? And I think immigration is good. My parents were immigrants to Canada. I'm an immigrant to the United States. I'm a big believer in immigration. Immigration accounts for almost all of the expected growth of the working population in the years to come. This is especially important for most Western countries now, which are aging. But there is more than economics in the arguments about immigration. There are very important non-economic costs and benefits. And I would say one of the things that I observed in by just reading some of the commentaries since the election is that smart people that I've been reading have said this is one of the dilemmas that the Democratic Party faces these days. And the Democratic Party, of course, has tied its future very closely to the demographics of immigration and diversity. Because Jeffrey Sachs, who's an economist at Columbia University and a left-to-center liberal with impeccable credentials, as he pointed out in a very, very perceptive interview recently, he said, the left doesn't have a language that acknowledges the need for borders and the need to police them, because it sounds chauvinistic to say that we need a limit on migration. The cultural frictions caused by demographics and immigration are compounded by the rise of Islamic terrorism. This terrorism does not represent an existential threat in a military sense to any Western democracy. Trump's travel ban on 7 majority Muslim countries, because he believes that they are the source of terrorist threats, could not possibly pass a cost-benefit test. By one estimate, the odds of an American dying at the hands of a refugee who becomes a terrorist are about 1 in 3.6 billion per year. But for Trump and other nationalists, this isn't about some bloodless cost-benefit calculation. Rather, they see in ISIS an organization that has ruthlessly exploited the trappings of globalization. They use social media from far away to radicalize susceptible recruits in Muslim communities in the West, to perpetrate acts of terror that are designed for maximum horror and impact. A nationalist sees that, and they would pay any economic or constitutional price to keep that out. But here we come to, I think, the crux of the question. By tying their cause so closely to these questions which border and raise these important issues of race and identity and religion, is nationalism becoming a vehicle for religious and ethnic or ethnic intolerance? Now, the nationalist leaders today insist that it is not. Marine Le Pen, for example, she says that she's merely defending France's secular character, the concept of laïcité, which is entrenched in the French Constitution, when she criticizes overt displays of Islamic observance. Mr. Trump says that he's as worried about struggling Latino and African Americans losing their wages and their jobs at the hand of, because of cheap foreign labor. It's not just Rust Belt white workers he's worried about. But there's no escaping the fact that the new nationalism often, intentionally or not, thrives on xenophobia. Mr. Trump has been criticizing free trade since the 1980s, but his candidacy really took off when he started attacking Mexican immigrants and Muslims. American Jewish groups heard unsettling echoes of anti-Semitic conspiracy theories when Mr. Trump accused Mrs. Clinton of meeting, quote, in secret with international banks to plot the destruction of U.S. sovereignty, unquote. Germany's Alternative for Deutschland party started as an anti-Euro party, but its support languished below 5%. Then when an influx of Middle Eastern refugees and migrants came in, stoking worries about crime and terrorism, AfD shifted its focus to Islam, which its manifesto declares is not a part of Germany. And now its support is between 10 and 15%. In other words, the nationalist preoccupation with Islamic terrorism is at least partly opportunistic. The more the public fears terrorists in their midst, the more they are amenable to the nationalist message. The question facing Western democracies now is what next? How far does nationalism go, and what are its implications, and what shape does it take? Now, we often refer to these as populist parties because they portray themselves as responding to the needs of the populists and not the corrupt elites. But the irony of this is that the populists are actually not that popular. No populist movement has yet won a resounding victory or formed a government with a majority vote, and only in Brexit did it actually command a majority vote. And even should a nationalist party win power, these are not the nationalists of the 1930s for the most part. They don't have designs on each other's territory. In fact, really what they want is just control back over their own territory. I would parenthetically say this is not true of Chinese and Russian nationalists, but that's kind of a different story. To succeed, I think, as a credible nationalist movement, they have to discard those remaining that remaining baggage of ethnic and religious intolerance. They will have to, but more, they will also have to demonstrate a clear, coherent set of policies to take the place of the institutions of globalism that they wish to tear down. And that they haven't done that yet. I mean, just look at Great Britain, where Theresa May is still trying to figure out exactly what comes next after they leave the European Union, because as it turns out, Britain's getting a lot of good stuff out of being part of the European Union that they now have to sacrifice. Trump really hasn't yet explained what how leaving these disastrous free trade agreements that he's always complaining about is going to make American workers better off, what he's going to replace them with. He hasn't done that. Nationalist movements, by their very nature, draw support from the slower growing older parts of their countries, the U.S. Rust Belt, Northern France, Eastern Poland. In the U.S., for example, there is a very strong inverse correlation between how Donald Trump performed versus how Mitt Romney performed as state, and how fast jobs grew. If you look at this again, and I promise you, I did not just choose these states to try and make my point. I actually did run a very rough correlation in all 49 states. I leave out Utah, which is a bit of an outlier. But the relationship is very, very strong. Basically, the weaker job growth was in the last 8 years, the more likely Donald Trump was going to improve upon Mitt Romney's performance. And why I think this is interesting is that we may forget that there were states that Hillary Clinton won, such as Maine, but the swing away from Obama Obama versus Clinton was 15 points. In other words, it wasn't enough just to look at Trump pulling off these surprise victories in blue states like Michigan, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin. He came very close in places like New Hampshire, Maine, and Minnesota, states that had huge, and Obama gigantic double-digit victories. And I use job growth here because job growth captures two things, both how well is the economy performing and how well is the population performing. A lot of these states actually have very low unemployment rates, and it's because so many people are leaving. And they're leaving because they don't see a future. And I think that's an important aspect. And in many of these states, it's not just about the fact that things have been tough for a long time, it's that they do not see them getting better. And at the same time, you can see the center of gravity moving towards the southwest. And that's why you saw, for example, states like Georgia and Texas, you know, reliably red states, starting to move into the purple column, you know? In fact, there are people who say that in 4 to 8 years, Texas will be a swing state. These implications are very interesting because they speak to what sort of temptations there are by nationalist leaders in terms of what policies do they want to pass. Do they want to pass policies that are designed to protect and reward the people who voted for them? Because if they do, then you will see policies such as protection for dying industries, limits on immigration, and more generous social transfers towards the elderly, all of which have been at one point or another part of Donald Trump's platform. Whatever benefits these have for people who really need protection, these are not the policies that guarantee strong future economic growth. But if the nationalists are still falling short of offering a true positive agenda in replacement of the globalists, it's also the case that globalists still have a lot of work to do. What are they going to offer in place, given how much people have clearly signaled a dissatisfaction with what the globalists have been offering? Well, the globalists need to start by recognizing their own mistakes. They should, for example, question whether they should always treat free trade as simply a way to achieve geostrategic aims. If you really want to create an alliance to hold back an expansionist and nationalistic China, then don't think that trading more with Japan or Malaysia is going to do it. Put some soldiers there, put men in the line or something like that. That's what this would do. Signing a free trade agreement with Japan is not nearly as important as the security alliance that we have with Japan. And it is not necessarily the case that today, when tariffs are so low, that the dislocations that free trade with another country are going to bring the United States are a price that needs to be inflicted on people once again. If the US wants, the same is true in Europe. If European statesmen should not let their enthusiasm for the European project blind them to how fundamental economic and cultural differences can prevent and get in the way of their hope for economic union, and in the end, overreaching can actually plant the seeds for dissolution later on. And also something very important, globalists should not fall into this temptation of thinking that opposition to open borders is equal to racism. Look, most Americans, we know from the polling data, are very supportive of illegal immigration, but they want legal immigrants to adopt American values, learn English, bring useful skills, and wait their turn. This, after all, is why Australia and Canada have much higher levels of legal immigration than the United States and have very strong public support for it, partly because they are very, very careful that the immigrants who come to their countries meet the definition of the people they think will help build the society, the multicultural society, with shared values that they want. Throwing the doors open to the world's downtrodden, it is a brave and noble humanitarian instinct. But it may, in the end, do more harm than good to the cause if it triggers a broader populist backlash. And that, I think, is kind of the lesson Angela Merkel has learned in Germany. Bottom line, the nation state has survived for three centuries for a reason. And as Barack Obama belatedly acknowledged the day after the election, for the majority of the American people, borders mean something. That's the end of my prepared remarks. I guess we have some time for questions. On your mind. I actually write about a lot of stuff. You know, I don't have knowledge or opinion, or knowledge or facts about everything, but that never stopped me from expressing opinion before. It will not stop me tonight. I think we have a couple of microphones, so if you could put up your hand, I'll get a microphone.
What exactly is the major arguments against NAFTA? You know, there's talk about, you know, changing this and that and the other thing, but what is the major Trumpian complaint?
I will say that as a starting point, I've always found the focus, Trump's focus on NAFTA, to be somewhat puzzling, because this was 20 years ago. The macroeconomic impact was very small, and it actually did achieve what Bill Clinton hoped. It actually did turn Mexico into a very friendly country. Our southern border has not been a problem now for over 20 years. Mexico has helped us a lot in a lot of non-economic areas, such as trying to slow down the drug trade. Studies have shown that NAFTA did, you know, inflict a lot of hardship on some American communities, especially those that were involved in textile trade. If you listen carefully, there are two things that Trump particularly doesn't like about the situation. Well, several things. First of all, it's resulted in a very large bilateral deficit between Mexico and the United States. Now, economists do not obsess over the trade deficit. They say trade deficits do not tell us anything about whether they're not good or bad. They just show the fact that one country consumes more than it produces. It has nothing to do with trade relations. But for Donald Trump, that's not the way it is. He thinks a trade deficit shows that something is unfair. He doesn't like the fact that Mexico has a value-added tax, which means that when they export something to us, that tax is taken off, whereas when we sell something to them, that tax is added on. Once again, economists can explain till they're blue in the face that this is not really discriminatory, but there you have it. That bothers Donald Trump a lot. And then there are sort of like more narrow things. So for example, a big chunk of the trade deficit is in the automotive area. It is definitely the case that over the last 10 years, a very large portion of the North American automotive assembly and manufacturing offering has moved to Mexico. Mexico now, I can't remember the numbers, but it's something like over 20% of cars sold in North America are built and assembled in Mexico. And that bothers Trump a lot. It bothers a lot of people. And some trade people, very thoughtful people, believe that the way NAFTA has been set up basically allows, for example, European automakers to come to Mexico and gain tariff-free access to all of the United States and Canada, and therefore that disadvantages the United States. So I suspect the central issue in the upcoming negotiation of NAFTA will be revisiting these rules of origin to make it harder for countries to basically use Mexico as an entry point without actually also sourcing some stuff in the United States. But again, I sort of start from the fact that if you really wanted to look at the trade deal that did not work out the way it was supposed to, you would look at China and WTO.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to ask a question, which is that, you know, America's always been a democracy, but really been a business democracy. And at a point now where the dollar's been the strongest it's been in the last 15, 20 years, what's the advantage of turning inside now when you finally have access to so much opportunity abroad to invest at cheap levels?
I have never seen the value of turning inward, so in some sense, I would call myself like a recovering globalist, or I should say chastened globalist, you know what I mean, in the sense that I've discovered that a lot of the world doesn't see the world the same I do. I would say the following. If you go back to that chart, the people who have benefited from being able to buy bonds and stocks and other investments in other countries, the Americans, they're all in that far right-hand corner, okay? So those people all believe very much in the globalist system. I think that the tension we're having are those people between the 80th and 95th level. They're the ones who just, you know, couldn't care less about the fact that they can now buy Brazilian bonds and Chinese stocks. And I think that the problem we've had since David Ricardo's day is that economists believe the purpose of all production is consumption. We aren't really trying to make workers better off, we're trying to make consumers better off. But once again, that is where they sort of fail to understand that people don't feel that same way, that people are workers and they're consumers, and that their lives as workers are all turned upside down sometimes by free trade. And so they don't necessarily believe that the trade-off has been a good one. Now, you bring up the dollar, and I'm glad you did, because actually, I'm going to segue to something which I think is very curious. Because a basic flaw in Donald Trump's view of economics is that he wants like a big tax cut, he wants to like boost American investment, he wants to grow at 4%, but he also wants to get rid of our trade deficit. And those two things are actually mutually exclusive, virtually. Because if we're gonna have an investment boom, the United States does not yet have the capacity to produce all those investment goods that companies are going to buy with their new lower tax rate. So what's gonna happen, we're gonna have an investment boom, we're gonna import a lot, the economy is going to heat up, the Federal Reserve is going to raise interest rates, and the dollar is going to shoot higher, and we'll end up with a larger trade deficit, not a smaller one. Now, every economist, including many who have advised Trump over the last few months, tell him that. And I hope that at some point he realizes this. Because if he doesn't, he's going to be trying to basically hit the brake and the gas pedal at the same time. You know, eventually the engine is going to explode through the hood of the car. I mean, just look at Mexico, right? I mean, he talked about putting a 20% tariff on Mexico. Well, since his election, the Mexican peso has fallen 20%. So they can actually sustain a 20% tariff and just be as competitive. My point is that the global economy is a very complex thing, and that what economics has shown us is that these kind of almost 19th century efforts to redress these various injustices by the tariffs and so on, they just don't work. I mean, back in the 70s, Jimmy Carter enacted a whole bunch of tariffs on I believe it was Japanese televisions, to protect the American television industry. So imports of televisions from Japan went down. And just like clockwork, imports of televisions from Mexico and Korea went up. And all those jobs still disappeared. You know, I'm a big believer that, like, when economic gravity is pulling you in one direction, no president can pull it in the other. And I think that what we're going to see is that if Trump's policies on the economy are successful, and I hope they're successful because I would love to have 4% growth, we're going to get a larger trade deficit. What I worry about is that he will not have to listen to his economists to tell him that that's okay, and it will sort of like simply sort of fire up his protectionist instincts. Any other questions?
Okay, back here.
Greg, if I understood you correctly, in your concluding remarks, you talked about immigration in Canada and Australia. And I thought I understood you to say that it was controlled, it was measured, it wasn't just unlimited. 20 years ago, I heard a chief economist from Deutsche Bank doing an assessment of the economies around the world, and one of the things he attributed to America's success at the time was a controlled immigration policy. Now, I'm not sure if I understand what that was, but has it changed between 20 years ago and now so that it's not controlled, or how did we get into this immigration stuff?
I think the basic framework of U.S. immigration policy is more or less established in the 1960s. And there are two ways, and I hope this will answer your question, in which the U.S. system differs fundamentally from the Canadian system. The first way is the U.S. system prioritizes family reunification as basically the path to naturalization. And so these figures are kind of rough numbers, but something like two-thirds of naturalizations are family reunification. And so green cards are handed out more or less on a quota basis according to how many countries by country. And so in Canada, on the other hand, they use a point system where candidates are assessed points according to things such as what is your education level? What is your ability to speak English and French? Do you have family here in Canada who can sponsor you so that you're not a burden on the state? And they basically allow the person to score as high as the point system to come in. This is a system that is very, very favorable to people with education and skills. And so in Canada, roughly, I think a quarter of people who are naturalized come in through family reunification. So I would say that as a first pass, that different focus of naturalization is one reason why probably Canadians, in some sense, are more intuitively in synchronizing with the idea that immigration is good for them, not just for the immigrants. The second big way that U.S. immigration differs from Canada is the illegal immigration. The level of illegal immigration that has come to the United States is magnitudes larger than what Canada or Australia suffered. And that's just geography. I mean, the United States has Mexico on its southern border, and Canada has the United States. And now, there are news reports about refugees flooding across the border in recent months. I don't think we're reaching U.S. levels of legal immigration, but bears watching. But the fact of the matter is, in some sense, Justin Trudeau can send these, you know, grand-sounding tweets about, you know, send us your sad and you're beaten and you're deprived and you're persecuted, because not many are going to come. It's hard to get to Canada, all right? Same with Australia, surrounded by water. You have to get into a boat to go there. And Australia is able to push those people away. And Australia has gotten a lot of criticism from the United Nations and others for the inhumane treatment of these refugees. But you can't argue that it worked. It has worked. And it has happened against a backdrop where Australia still accepts per capita more refugees than the United States does, and far more legal immigrants than the United States does. So I guess what I'm trying to say is, in thinking about immigration policy, you have to separate what might be our ideal humanitarian globalist policy, which would be very welcoming to people from who are fleeing persecution in other countries, and recognize what the absorption capacity of their societies are. And I think that's a balance the United States hasn't gotten right. But I do also believe that the elements of getting that balance right are there. So if you look at the Gang of Eight proposal that was before the Senate idea a few years ago that could not get past the House, that included path to citizenship, expansion of green card, the path to citizenship for illegals, expanded green cards, improved border security, and a point system. Bang, 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 bang. All those things were the elements of a package that the vast majority of Americans would have supported. Unfortunately, the nature of our politics, which is a whole other story, did not allow that thing to come to pass, which is very unfortunate.
Greg,
Oh, sorry, we'll come to you next, okay? We have a question over here, yeah.
Greg, what, you put your futurist cap on for a few minutes.
Just don't trade on it.
On trader, you traded in, okay. My question is, what does President Le Pen say to Chancellor Merkel this summer? Is the EU over with or not?
Well, first of all, if she wins a presidency, it's highly unlikely that her party will win the parliamentary elections a month later. And so if she doesn't control the parliament, then she actually cannot take France out of the Euro and the European Union. She can, however, have a referendum on these things. Now, the referendum isn't necessarily binding, but it can move France in that direction. Now, as the election has approached, the National Front has started to try and sketch out what their plan would be in this post-euro world. Well, initially we'll have an alternative currency, which will trade alongside the euro. Well, anybody who owns a French euro bond right now is not having any of that, okay? I'm not hanging around waiting to be paid back in some French franc that's immediately going to plunge against the mighty euro. And so you're already seeing the French bond market react to that. On the European Union, what she has said is that we want a much looser version of EU. And part of that is getting back control over the borders, just like Great Britain does. What she's going to find, and this will probably be something Angela Merkel tells her, is exactly what Theresa May has found, which is that saying I want to get out of these things is one thing, and actually getting out of them is really, really hard. You know, I mean, it's like this entire, like, it's like 30 years of marriage, you know what I mean? Like, suddenly, like, getting separate checking accounts and all this, it's really hard. And you discover there's a lot of feelings there, you know? And maybe this wasn't such a great idea, you know? Maybe we shouldn't have been throwing China at each other. Maybe we should have sat down and worked it all out. So I think it's an interesting conversation. What I think is the thing I worry about is almost like circumstances taking on a sort of self-fulfilling prophecy aspect to them. If she becomes president, you're going to see much more turmoil in the markets. You're going to see, like, I think it's a much bigger deal than Brexit was to Great Britain. Right? You know, Britain never had a monetary union with the rest of Europe. You know, essentially we were redoing trade relations, right? France is a core country in the Euro area. And essentially breaking a determined president can get France out of the Eurozone. And you know, the European Central Bank stood by to buy the bonds of Greece or Portugal if it was necessary during the first part of the crisis. But that was conditional on those countries agreeing to an austerity plan from the European Commission. I can guarantee Marine Le Pen is not going to the European Commission and asking for an austerity plan. Heck no, she wants to open the floodgates, open the purse strings, and like go full bore on left-wing French statist policy. So I would anticipate those few months being much more economically challenging than we have seen in the wake of Brexit.
Next question is here.
And Justin, can you get a microphone after this?
Go ahead. Go ahead.
So since my major is in risk management, so my question is related with the risk. So I want to hear your opinion about the political risk on the US stock market right now. Because I mean, in the one side, since the Donald Trump election, we see the S&P 500 has risen up nearly 20%. But about the timeline of the policy, the tax cut and the deregulation on the financial sector, all of them just remain uncertainty. And on the other hand, we got some French election in May, and we got Germany election in September, and we also have some China's top leadership commission transition in this year's November. So what do you think this kind of a political events gonna have some effects on the US stock market or on this current economy?
Well, I would say the first thing is that everybody in this room has to go and subscribe to the Wall Street Journal right now. This is going to be an interesting year. And we have the best reporters in the world. They're going to give you great insight on every one of those issues you just rhymed off. Now, in my designated role of making it up as I go along, I'm actually not going to talk about the Chinese National People's Congress because I genuinely don't know anything about that. I would say that one thing we've learned in the last year is that, as I wrote in my column today, political uncertainty is kind of a wet firecracker. It turns out that it just hasn't mattered as much as we saw. You know, we had the Brexit vote. There's been some damage of British investment, but consumers are just fine. you know, after the Italian referendum, we thought, and the constitutional referendum was defeated, they thought there would be a big run on Italian banks. Actually, the Italian banks have turned out to be fine. Donald Trump's election, you know, initially, like, the market sold off for all of about 6 hours, and then it's been, like, going up ever since. So I think we've learned a couple of things. First of all, let's remember at the end of the day, these are all market economies, and the things that matter most are market forces, not political forces. And I know from studying American political history that there are very few occasions when what the president does really matters to the near-term direction of the economy. What the Federal Reserve does matters a lot, but what the president does seldom matters. Now, in the case of Donald Trump, investors had to basically grapple with two things. Here's a guy who has very pro-business domestic policy. He wants to reduce regulation, he wants to reduce taxes, et cetera, et cetera. That would be good for stocks. But he also is very, very hostile to free trade. He has threatened to start a trade war with China and other countries. That would be very bad for stocks. What we have seen since he was elected is a lot more attention to the first than the second. He has signed a couple of executive orders aiming to roll back regulation. He's already signed into law a congressional bill that's designed to undo some of Obama's last regulation. People really like that. And what has he done on the trade front? Well, he pulled the United States out of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, but that thing was just on paper anyway. And, you know, people weren't exactly committed to it in the first place. He's had a bunch of phone calls with leaders. You know, he basically got into a chatting match with Australia, you know, that like big evil country out there that's always trying to undercut us. And it had nothing to do with trade, right? Whereas he has a phone call with Xi Jinping and it's all chummy and friendly and so on. He has a nice meeting with Shinzo Abe, meeting with Justin Trudeau, like the issue of trade never even comes up. So what we've seen, I think, is that like more of the good stuff, not so much of the bad stuff from Trump. And I would say that I think people sort of fool themselves into thinking that protectionism is a near-term risk in the stock market. There just isn't a lot of economic history or theory that would say that more higher tariffs are going to tank the stock market. Other stuff is way more important. The other thing that's been going on is that, in some sense, Trump's election occurred against a backdrop of a lot of catalysts that have been positive for the U.S. economy. So 3 weeks after the election, something very important happened in the global economy that almost everybody now has forgotten about. And that is OPEC reached a production cut agreement. And they haven't been able to do that, I believe, since 2008. And why does it matter? Well, because the plunge in the price of oil over the prior year had been playing havoc with the shale industry here in the United States. It had been tanking all sorts of areas of industrial production. And it was causing severe hardship to a lot of emerging markets because it was dragging all commodity prices down. And it was playing havoc with people's expectations. The central banks everywhere were saying, holy cow, we're going to have to cut interest rates deeply into negative territory to stop these deflationary forces. Now that oil has firmly above $50 and the OPEC agreement is holding, we've seen a reversal in many of those deflationary and disinflationary forces. And believe it or not, given that we're all taught that inflation is bad, this is actually a good thing. It means that central banks don't have to do a lot of funky stuff with negative interest rates, and that's been good news for banks. So a huge part of the stock market rally has been banks rallying. Is some of that because Donald Trump wants to reduce financial regulation? Yeah, some of it, but banks are up just as much in Europe. And that's partly because they're now looking forward to when they don't have to deal with this really horrendous interest rate environment any longer. So I'd say there's a lot of positive things happening in the global economy right now. That said, we're now trading at 20 times earnings on the S&P 500. That is historically quite rich. I would say that people are perhaps getting a bit too optimistic about the path of economic growth and profits. As I say, presidents can typically affect these things only at the margin, and I'm just not convinced that there's a lot that Trump, even if he gets everything right, can do to raise the underlying level of economic growth. But I think that generally speaking, after what I've seen in the last year, I worry less about political uncertainty per se causing a big market event, unless we're talking about a big one, you know, like a huge, like a war or some huge incident between us and Iran or North Korea. If that, we'll have to call a different speaker.
Go ahead.
Yeah,
whoever has the microphone, please go ahead.
Okay, just make sure Jason needs to ask questions.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, this is Mir Mawasi. I'm an international student from Afghanistan, and I'm studying Master of Financial Risk Management at UConn. Pleasure to be here among you all. My question is that there is a growing consensus among the nationalists that favors nationalism over globalism, and that is that when there is more globalization, more free trade, so big companies or big or some other countries can wipe out your local markets by introducing their goods and services with cheaper prices. How would you respond to this issue? Thank you.
Well, I mean, what you just basically stated is a classic framework for globalization that is primarily the economic global phenomenon. And interestingly enough, that is why, up until 10 or 15 years ago, most of the opposition to globalization came from the left, not from the right. I mean, it's interesting that in Europe right now, it's the right-wing nationalist parties that want out of the European Union, because for most of its history, it was the left-wing parties complaining that the European Commission was this tool of neoliberalism that was forcing all these countries to get rid of the traditional safety net and the prerogatives of the state. So what you see today is kind of like almost an amalgamation of the traditional left-wing complaints about corporate power hurting, you know, the ability of the state to be, you know, an activist intervener in people's lives for greater good, melding in with much more of a cultural overlay from right-wing nationalists who see corporations as basically having no loyalty, no patriotism within their country. So you take the issue of immigration, for example. Big multinationals want to be able to bring more immigrants into the United States because not enough Americans are graduating with advanced degrees in science, technology, and engineering, and so forth, from American universities. And if they don't have access to that type of talent, they want to be able to recruit that talent overseas. Nationalists respond to that, well, the problem is because you're not paying enough. All you want is cheap labor. If you would double your salaries, you'd get all the people that you want. And this is kind of the sorts of debates that we're having now, right, over whether multinational businesses are hurting the national character and are putting the interests of their shareholders ahead of the nation as defined by these nationalists. Now, I'm a believer that there is no that's a false choice between the well-being of Americans here and the well-being of those immigrants who come here to do those jobs that are very difficult to find Native born Americans to do. There's a variety of research that shows that especially skilled immigrants coming to the United States improve the productive performance of the companies for which they work. I mean, a staggering number of Silicon Valley startups have an immigrant as one of their founders. But this sort of like goes back to this thing, is that for a lot of working class Americans, they don't see that. So those are the types of, I think, tensions and debates that mark today's nationalist versus globalist argument.
And this will have to be the last question because we have to get in to catch a train.
Thanks, Greg. The since that the political voting is very heavily influenced by the perception of the employment situation, but the employment situation are affected by the large corporations being more efficient and also by the technology change, especially on the digital technology, which is enabling this very rapid globalization. Could you share with us your thought on this technology impact on the globalism and the nationalism? Thank you.
Well, I mean, Jason, you're absolutely right. I mean, over time, the evidence is incontrovertible. But the main reason jobs in certain industries disappear is not because of foreign competition. It's because technology comes along that enables the same goods and services to be produced with fewer people. And I think fundamentally people sort of get that. It shouldn't take away that there have been significant dislocations due to foreign trade as well. I think that, so when economists are asked their opinion, and they are increasingly not asked their opinion these days, unfortunately, but when they are asked their opinion, they say, look, you know, Joseph Schumpeter calls this creative destruction. New businesses are always coming along, old businesses are disappearing. You know, when Japanese autos came to the United States, they didn't just put some American workers out of job. They also showed the ones who stayed behind how to do their jobs better. As a result, we all get to drive better cars. You know what I mean? Like Macy's is laying off, you know, Donald Trump complains about 2,000 jobs being outsourced to Mexico. Macy's laid off 5 times that many people this year because of Amazon, right? And Amazon is enabling me to do stuff that I could never do before. It's a great convenience. And this is kind of the story of Western civilization. And so if economists are asked their opinion, they say, look, we've got to find ways to help those people who got laid off from Macy's or had their jobs outsourced to Mexico do the jobs that are being created now. Like, what are the jobs that we're going to create tomorrow? And there are a lot of those jobs out there. It turns out that when stuff gets cheaper, people buy more of it. So Panera Bread, for example, they're replacing, I can't swear this is true, but I read it somewhere, but what they've done is replaced some of their cashiers with sort of kiosks, and what they discovered is that they can now handle a lot more meals, and so they need more cooks. 30 years ago, everybody thought ATMs meant that there would not be bank tellers any longer. Turns out there's more bank tellers, banks have more employees than ever now. And the reason why was the arrival of the ATM made it much cheaper to open a bank branch. Yeah. And it turns out that bank branches still need employees. Those employees are not cashiers. Those employees are like loan officers or investment product specialists. So you can never figure out what technology is going to do. But the constant we know is that it's always going to create demand for different sorts of jobs. And we shouldn't try and sort of stand against it. We should facilitate the process of doing that. I mean, the United States does a terrible job in that respect. And I would really love to see this administration pay more attention to that, like a little bit more effort into that, you know, tough on-the-ground work of matching the people who've been dislocated by technology and by competition into paths of jobs. Now, it's really, you know, it's not pleasant to be 50 years old and to be competed or to be digitized out of a job and told that your choice is to basically go on disability or to move to San Francisco and live in an 800-square-foot studio apartment, you know, competing with a bunch of 20-year-olds writing code for $20,000 a year. That sounds like funeral insurance, frankly. So part of what you're hearing is that people understand rationally why their job has disappeared, but it's not nice to be told that, and it's not pleasant what lies ahead. And the geographic aspect of this is very interesting, and that's why I sort of keep going back to this sort of picture. I mean, some of these counties that went for Trump, I mean, they were 90% for Trump, like in some of these counties in western Pennsylvania, even in parts of Connecticut and Massachusetts, I guess. These are towns that are like depopulating, dying. And partly it's because the nature of growth in the future is increasingly knowledge-based, and it turns out the knowledge-based industries tend to prefer cities, and they prefer people with college degrees. They prefer all those things that these cities do not offer. And that's a very painful reality, and I think that's kind of a new and different and painful aspect of the dislocations that we're going through. And I don't have answers to all those things, but these are the questions we need to be asking. These are the problems we need to be studying, because simply, you know, getting on Twitter and yelling at this company not to outsource 500 jobs, you know, that's basically 15 minutes of job losses that you just reversed, okay? The problem is bigger than that. That's all I have to say.